Welcome everybody to my talk on Stack and JS Xtra for e-learning and engineering mechanics, as already was said. I will start with the introduction motivation, go over the program Stack and JS Xtra, and the concept and role of MacLib will be explained. I will illustrate that with some examples, perhaps also live, but depends on time. And then I will give some info on the state of development of this project and summary and outlook, and finalize with acknowledgements. I keep the introduction short. I've been on all JS Xtra conferences, so you find a longer introduction earlier. I am teaching undergraduate and postgraduate courses of engineering mechanics and the like for students of mechanical engineering. And besides that, I am busy with the application of and the contribution to free software. I already mentioned SMAT Studio. And oh, screen sharing. Yes. Now better?
Yes, better. Thank you.
Okay, then I just go on. So with several free software, I am quite busy. So Moodle and Stack, the result is shown here, and I'm also busy with SMAT Studio and Calculix. Calculix is an finite element code, and SMAT Studio, a general purpose mathematics program, just like MathCAD, which is very good, well suited for performing and documenting engineering calculations because of its very good unit handling. Okay, what is the role of e-learning materials in my engineering mechanics courses? I use them for formative assessment. This is sort of mechanics gym, so to say, a training field for self-paced learning with instant feedback. So the benefit over homework assignment with later feedback on paper is that the students get the feedback immediately. And summative assessment, I also use a Stack and JS Xtra for homework assignments, which have a final grade stake in them. So they contribute to the final grade of this course. And yeah, I could potentially use that in e-exams, but I did not do that so far because I can't cover the complete spectrum of skills which I want to evaluate, in particular skills on handling and creating of graphs and drawings. And that's what this talk is about. The technical base at our university is the Moodle Learning Management System and the question type stack. And as I already mentioned, graphical skills, they are very important. And so I need graphical input possibilities for e-assessment. For instance, if I want to let the students create system sketches for as a base for mathematical modeling, or the use of graphoanalytical methods like this one. Here you, in principle, do geometric calculations in order to find function plots, and also to visualize quantities, which I show later. And the easy way to do at least some evaluation of these skills is to use multiple choice. So you can give a system, and then you can provide a choice of sketches which match the system, which are free body diagrams, for instance, of these systems, or you have a system and you have to drag and drop the correct curves onto the right places here, which essentially is also a multiple choice question. But the problem is, I do not really evaluate the ability to create these sketches, but just to pick some of a given choice. And by sort of, by finding contradictions or whatever, it is easier to select than to do a lot of decisions in order to come up with the correct one. So what I want to have is shown here. That's part, these are screenshots, of course, of what I already have. Essentially is that, or the essential issue is that I can edit graphs. So I can add objects, can move them around, can label them. And there is detailed formative feedback, because this is for self-learning asynchronous study. And this some easier part of this is to modify curves in order to give the correct function graph. And again, there is not just a right or wrong, because you might understand that if you modify a sketch and add objects, there's a lot of choices to make, because you have to choose the labels, you have to choose the directions and the positions of all these things. And that's much more decisions than just right or wrong. And if you get the feedback wrong, then it could be everything if you have no idea how to do it exactly. So the basis, to come back to our tools, is the stack question type in Moodle. We have already heard some explanations what this is today, and most of you know this. And I just want to mention the computer algebra system in the background, the flexible response trees for feedback, and also the extensibility by interactive graphics using JSX Graph. And the availability of that tool guided me to use JSX Graph, and I was happy with the interactive performance and with the high level objects. So I thought I can understand that. And there's an extensive documentation, and last not least, there is outstanding support by the JSX Graph team. And Alfred and me, we email a lot, and it is always very fast that I get response. I'm really excited by that. And what is also technically important is the well-established, I mean, described in the documentation of Stack, bidirectional interface between Stack and JSX Graph, the unidirectional interface we have seen multiple times today already is the text injection. So we have our JSX Graph code, and we can put in there contents of question variables by this type of injection. So whatever is in the variable is put in as verbatim text here, and then it is part of the JavaScript code to be executed. But there's more to it, because if you want to interact with the graph and want to get the interactions evaluated by Stack, you need a two-sided bidirectional interface, and that's via shared access to DOM objects, for instance, input fields. And here in the HTML question text, you define the input fields with their names, and in the JSX graph, you convey these names in order to share the access. So if you have a Stack and JSX graph questions, you have the question variables, that's where the math is done. You have some maxima code for generating randomized variables, the teacher's answer, so the model solution. And then you have seen this multiple times today, you have a part in the question text where you embed a JSX graph widget, which is essentially JavaScript code using the objects of the JSX graph library. And this screenshot here shows the code necessary for creating this widget here in the background, where you essentially have to move around a circle and a line to given points according to the given figures here. And so this JavaScript block is problem specific. And whenever you want to do such a question, then you have to copy this from an earlier question, or you have to reinvent how you did that. And you have to remake all decisions, how the colors should be and how the point sizes should be. And if you do not write a handbook for that, then you won't get all these things consistent. So I decided to try to avoid this and write sort of a collection of JavaScript objects for the JSX graph, which then can be used in a way that the question text is entirely, at least the JavaScript widget, of course, is entirely problem independent, generic. And all the content of the widget is controlled by information produced in the question variables on Maxima's side. So it is a list of lists, and these lists start with an object name and the arguments that I need to define that object. And if I use that throughout my questions in the same way, then I do not need to know JavaScript, of course. As an author of MacLib, I need to know, but as an apply, I do not need. So I can ask student assistants to make such sketches and they learn it very fast. And the appearance is consistent and the objects are tailored to my needs so far. If there are other needs, one could tailor to those. So we have a set of objects, and these objects can be linked into the question from a website. So Stack has the option to link to outside for parts of the question text and also of the question variables. So I can introduce functions from my GitHub repository, and I can introduce whatever JavaScript code from my GitHub repository. And this is very well suited for bulk production of consistent stuff. And a benefit of this approach is that my sketches, they entirely reside inside Stack. So I do not need any additional drawing tools or handling of files. And whoever gets this question can easily edit it and modify the these things to the needs. This is an overview of the objects that we already have in MacLib. So you can build a lot of system sketches, schematics out of these objects. Part of them are interactive. These with the red control points, they are interactive. You can drag them around. Somewhere is background noise. I don't know who didn't mute his mic. I show some examples. One benefit of the approach is that I can just, I learned that from Alfred. He always, when he explains something, he uses JS Fiddle. And the code, the base code of MacLib can be executed as it is in JS Fiddle, and you can play around with these lists of objects also in JS Fiddle. And if you follow this link, then you just see this and you will understand how it is defined. Showing off of some system sketches, which you can do with this set of objects. The first application I did, series of harvesting the benefits of this library approach, was non-interactive illustrations, static ones, of course, partly randomized. I made sort of 200 or 300 of such questions already in the last years. And some interactive stuff here again. The example I already showed, just three lines, three objects define this the widget in this graph. So you have the grid object, which defines, of course, the window and the coordinate system. You have a circle with two points and a line with two points, and that's it. What you need to create that drawing. Of course, you need a little bit more to do the evaluation later, but that's on Maxima's side, and that's not topic here on this conference, as I understood. So I left that out. Then another question, which is interactive, shows some more objects, and it has interactive objects which not will be graded, but which help to solve the task. The task is, and I may perhaps switch to the live system. The task is to find the center of rotation of this connection rod in this crank and piston mechanism. And you should put the crosshair to where you think the center of rotation is. The center of rotation is normal to the velocity vectors of some points of this rigid body. So this point moves horizontally. And so I use a helper line to create that. Yeah. Should do. And it is the velocity of the other end is tangential to the circle and normal to the crank. So the center of rotation should be in line with the crank. And I have these helper lines. The intersection points, they actually are not default part of MacLib. To find these intersection points and make them snap for the crosshair, that has been added with a few lines of JavaScript after the MacLib link. So you can enhance these things, and it's now you check, and this should not take too long. Thanks to huge improvements on the stack side, the performance has much improved in the last year. And so if I put this in the wrong place, of course, I get some sort of feedback. And it tells me that I'm 2.4 grid units away from the correct solution. So that's what can be done here, or for this example. I've given in the slides some more information. And for instance, one part of a stack question is also the general feedback, the work solution. And here I add two objects to my list of objects and create another JSX graph, and where the velocity vectors are given. Now to the free body diagrams. This was the initial intention to have an editor for these things. And 2 years ago, I presented a sort of a proof of concept here at this first instance of this series of conferences. And now I am at the point where I can already give feedback to these drawings in automatic way. And so the task is to remove the supports and to replace it by forces and label these forces. And later one has to use that for equilibrium conditions and make reference to these labels. And in order to check that, I need to know the labels, and that was part of the proof of concept. So the editor has to allow for activation and deactivation of objects. It needs to provide new objects. So you have creators or generators of forces and moments with the option to edit their labels. You can drag around the control points as usual in a JSX graph. I just stick to that concept. And if I did a label wrong, then I just delete the object and create a new one. So perhaps we can allow for another interactive impression. If I have this question, I have to replace the support by forces and label them correctly. And if I do nothing, then I already get feedback what I should do. So the support at A and B is not deactivated. So I do that. If I don't know how to do it, I look up it here. And I check again. So there's no reaction at A and no reaction force at B. Okay, I have to create reaction forces. Okay, then I drag some forces here and I put it, let's say here, and I put one here because I'm new to engineering mechanics and I don't know what to do. And let's see what the feedback will be. A lot of complaints. So at A, there should be three reactions at least, because that is a built-in support with which doesn't allow for any movement. And so it needs two forces in two directions and a moment to prevent rotation. And here there's just one restricted direction. And the comment is that the force doesn't have the correct direction. So the support actually acts in vertical direction and I should rotate that. So if I do that, then the complaint might vanish, but still it's not happy. It's partially correct, but the name is not good, because if I have a support B, then there should be sufficient a force with name B, and that's what I can do here. Remove that, get it here, rotate it, and then we will see if that gets green. Yes, okay. I won't go through the complete example because we will get out of time. So here's some facts on MATLAB for the objects. Approximately 40 lines per object, one could guess. A lot of application already. In order to tell the student assistants how to do it, I have made an extensive documentation, or extensive is exaggerated, but the maturity of the documentation is perhaps better than the maturity of the livery itself. You have a list of objects, a table with examples, and if you click that, then you get a page dedicated to the particular object, and also relation to feedback on this object. There are feedback functions in Maxima with also 20, 30 lines to realize this formative feedback and assessment. So currently, I'm settled with the number of objects, more or less. I'm not adding them easily now. I focus on adjustment to new JSX graph versions or to new stack versions. And that's there's a lot to do, because sometimes there are new bugs which I have to work around in every of these several hundred questions. And extensions which I'm looking forward to is that currently I focus on the feedback functions, debug them and improve them, make the feedback more helpful. And also I want to add interactivity and animations to objects so that I just add some lines and then these things can be interactive, or more than it is now. Yeah, if you're interested in using that or contributing to it, then I'm open for consulting, training, cooperation, whatever. Skip that summary and just go to the acknowledgments. The Department of Engineering at our university has funded student assistance sometimes. And so it is not a big funded project. I do it just as part of my teaching work. And I have to thank the Moodle and the Stack team for providing that platform and these powerful tools, in particular Matti Harjula, who supported me a lot with the migration to Stack 4.4. And he already mentioned this, that a lot of improvements have been done with MacLib in mind. And in particular, I am very happy about this linking from external sources into the question text, because that enables me to improve the questions by improving the library and not having to touch every question every time I want to improve something. And Antti Rassila, he is the curator of the Abacus database, where we already have MacLib questions. And Alfred Wassermann, I already mentioned and want to repeat that here. So thank you for your attention, and I'm looking forward to your questions, if any.
Thank you very much, Martin. That was really impressive. Do your colleagues at other university use your library as well?
Not so far. I have had some discussions on the Stack user meeting in spring, but it turned out that they are not planning. So they had a project with several coworkers. But they actually were hoping to just take questions, Stack questions, and use them for their courses. And I had to take them to remove that illusion, I think, because I found that the questions from the Abacus database, they at least needed revision and adjustment to at least in terms of notation and things like that.
Okay.
So you usually can't use it as it is. And I think you will see that on GitHub, there is no star on my repository so far. In contrast to my Calculix repository, which has a lot of stars and which already went to the archive program, but it is on a very early stage of development. And so far, I can't exclude that. There's every other day someone is cloning that repository, but I don't know what they do with it. I have never got any question on it.